On the Higher Side Chats, we explore the world's deepest conspiracies, its mysteries, and the all-around fringe on a quest that can't be sponsored by anyone but the loyal listeners looking to take that ride. So if you enjoy the first hour of the show, courtesy of those subscribers, we hope that you'll consider becoming one for just $5 a month, and you'll get a second hour of each THC episode where we pack in twice as much interesting content with all our great guests. Just sign up on our members' website at thehiresidechatsplus.com, and you'll have instant access to all the extended content since Plus began, an opportunity to make topics and guest suggestions, and your own custom RSS feed, where you'll hear the full two-hour show in one convenient, uninterrupted file. And most importantly, you won't hear this repetitive reminder at the start of every show that listener-supported communities are the future of media and entertainment. And you want to be part of that future, don't you?
You have one new message.
Hey, Greg, this is Dust. Just wanted to call in and thank you for all the episodes that you do and all the shows. They're awesome, man. Really enjoyed the Crow 777 episode, and it made my hair stand up on end when he mentioned the transparent triangles that he saw on the night of the supermoon, because I had a similar experience on the night of the blue moon in 2011, well, the night before, actually. I saw a rainbow manifest around the moon. It was a circular rainbow at first. It was large around the moon, so anyways, the moon bow slowly turned into a hexagon, and that was amazing in itself. And within my field of vision, I could see a plane coming by, and all of a sudden I could see a clear, transparent triangle go alongside of it. And it went alongside of it for about 2 seconds, seemed to slow down when it was right alongside the plane. And then about 2 seconds later, it sped off. There was no sound. There was no thrusters of any kind from the ship or whatever it was. It was awesome. It was an awesome experience. My hair was standing on end, goosebumps all over. Don't know what quite to make of it, but it was an awesome experience. Thought I would share it with y'all. Peace.
In the 1930s, President Franklin Delano Roosevelt addressed the nation through a series of radio broadcasts known as the Fireside Chats. His aim was to reassure the common man that our society would recover from its troubled times. But we're far from 1930, and I deal with a different kind of fire. For a new era of worldly frustration, we offer a fresh conversation. I'm Greg Carlwood, and these are the Higher Side Chats.
How's it going, Higher Side Chatters? Better every day, I hope. From sunny San Diego, I'm Greg Carlwood, and you know I'm drinking a little drink, smoking a little smoke, and trying to get my mind right for a far-out show that I think really makes some great connections between ancient aliens and ancient history, the races and blood types, the elite and the bloodlines, the inner earth and abductions, reptilian beings and a century-long manipulation of humanity, and a thousand other threads on the conspiracy sweater. No one's freezing out in the cold tonight. I don't know what more you'd want from a THC. But we all know humanity has a rich history of experiences with a wide variety of strange humanoids, including Bigfoot, the Greys, reptilians, gnomes, fairies, and many other things. While still mysterious, the popular motif is that Bigfoot lives in the woods, the Greys are from Zeta Reticuli, and the rest may be some type of multidimensional beings, but maybe all these things are a lot more connected than previously thought, and there's a strong case to be made that the places they call home reside right beneath our feet. Well, today's guest, William Michael Mott, is one of the leading voices that has been taking that position in his book, Caverns, Caldrons, and Concealed Creatures, now in its third edition. It's considered by many to be some of the most comprehensive and entertaining work on this subject, and I couldn't agree more. I'm psyched to have him here. Mike Mott, my man, welcome to THC.
Thank you, Greg. I appreciate it, man. I really appreciate the invitation.
Yeah, this is going to be awesome. I love the idea that other types of intelligent humanoid beings live inside the Earth. And it's quickly becoming one of my favorite topics. And I think you make some great points that the larger UFO, cryptid, paranormal community has missed. But to start us off, a lot of this involves going back and looking at old myths and legends from different parts of the world, areas we're told had no communication in those days. And we find these commonalities in their stories that are really so similar in some cases, it's hard to believe that they would spawn independently in different parts of the world if they weren't based on some real experiences. Would you say that's one of the prevailing thoughts that kind of links up a lot of these arguments you make in the book?
Well, sure. I mean, if you think about it, throughout history, that we've always believed, and I mean, we collectively as human beings all over the planet, we've believed in not just a spiritual other world, but in physical other worlds that physically exist. Mm-hmm. And, you know, they called them fairy lands or whatever in Northern Europe and by different names around the globe. But the general idea is that there are others who live there and who occasionally come into our area, take what they need, and then they leave. They come and they take genetic material a lot of times, whether it's from people or animals or crops, and they seemingly vanish without a trace. And this is something that goes all the way back into antiquity, and we see this even today with the UFO phenomenon. You know, we have this whole idea that UFOs come from far away, and because we're told that, we've been conditioned to believe that these are extraterrestrial beings, which really works to the advantage of any race or species, you know, group of species that is living here with us. If they're taking advantage of us and our world and our realm, I guess you could say, but they don't want us to put a stop to it, then it's totally within their interest to have us, you know, look at the stars and say, oh, well, they come from up there. We can't stop them. You know, we can't interfere with what they're doing. Oh, right. Because, you know, again and again, you'll find this in UFO encounters. You'll find this whole theme of, oh, yeah, we come from up there. We come from this star system and that star system. And it's such an obvious, to me anyway, misdirection where they're saying, we come from far, far away. Look up there. But, you know, don't look under your oceans. Don't look under those mountains over there. You know, don't look deep in that wilderness area. Just look up there, because that's where we really come from. And, you know, this is something that goes all the way back into antiquity, like you were saying, because with Zeus, for instance, you know, Zeus would come down and he would purloin what he wanted from the mortal women and so forth. And, of course, that was always about genetics, really, if you look at those stories. And then he would go back to his faraway place, Mount Olympus, which was supposedly so high that no human being could ever reach Olympus. So it was always, look at us. We're way up there. We're out of your reach. You can't possibly do anything about it. And so I think that this is a theme that we see constantly and consistently updated throughout the history of anomalous encounters.
Yeah, I agree. And in terms of the UFO story, I had never really thought about that before, but you make a great point that why should we trust these entities outright, especially if they're doing strange experiments on us? A lot of times people say they're very painful.
Right.
And I guess the argument could be that there's no risk in telling us where they're from if we can't reach there with our technology, but
Or if we believe that we can't.
Right, right.
And look, it's like this. Okay, I'm going to go on a couple of points here. And this is talking about, first let me say that, you know, think of the Earth as a huge living thing and a huge biosphere. We're finding now what are called extremophile organisms living in all sorts of hostile environments, including far beneath the Earth. If there are other civilizations that have reached a high level of development, which I believe that there were in the past, which were destroyed or had to retreat, whether it was from conditions on the surface becoming less conducive to their health or war or whatever it might have been, then obviously the place to go would be underground and under the oceans. And more UFOs are seen coming and going from volcanoes, mountaintops, mountainsides, and more than any are seen coming from large bodies of water, including our oceans, coming and going, or seen over large bodies of water. Mm-hmm. So that being said, if these beings are so advanced that they can travel across the galaxy, they can warp space and time or create a wormhole or exceed the speed of light or whatever it is they supposedly can do to come way out here to the edge of the galaxy in the boondocks where we live, if they're really that advanced, then if there's something wrong with their genetics or whatever the current theme is, because actually that's the theme that goes all the way back, is that these beings have always wanted our genetics.
Right.
But if there's some sort of emergency and they're coming here to get genetics, if they're so advanced that they can warp space and time and create wormholes or whatever they do to do what they do, they would be able to repair their genetics. They could rewrite their genetic code. They could repair any errors in their code, because we're reaching the point now where we can almost do that.
Yep.
Okay. So another thing to think about here is, if these beings are so advanced, why don't they just come and get what they need and never even wake anybody up? Why don't they just come in, you know, put down a dampening EM field, something that suppresses, well, I think that's what they do anyway, but something that really suppresses, you know, your awareness, makes you stay asleep, take what they need painlessly, and leave
mm-hmm.
if they're really advanced. But no, they come in, they make a big spectacle. There's a little sadomasochism involved, a little dominance going on here with these things. It's sort of this whole Pavlovian conditioning. It seems to me to be designed to create a Stockholm syndrome sort of reaction in the people that they repeatedly victimize. They come in and they create painful and terrifying encounters with people. And then they basically say, oh, you're special, you're chosen, you know, we're just here to help you, we created you, blah, blah, blah. But really, if they were that advanced, why would they have to do that? Supposedly, they're telepathic. Well, if they're telepathic, then why don't they know about all the terror and anger and anguish that they cause these people?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Why do they keep doing it? Okay, so my point is that these beings are somehow related to us genetically, or else they would not be able to interact with us in the way that they do. They are probably part of the biodiversity of the Earth to some extent anyway. And by that, I'm touching on the subject of the Nephilim here. But they are part of the biodiversity here. They're very interested in genetics of both people and animals. And, you know, if they were from far away, like I said, first of all, they'd be able to fix their own genetic problems. And second of all, they wouldn't be so fascinated with ours.
I agree. And you've also stated in the book, a lot of these things seem super foreign, but they're not. They're really all just humanoid forms with slight variations.
Right.
And if it was something from the other side of the galaxy, you'd think we'd be seeing some like giant amoeba or some kind of like really radically different thing. And that's not the case.
Right. Or we might not even recognize it. And I'm not saying that there aren't other humanoid forms in the galaxy.
Right.
I have no doubt that there probably are. But these guys... Occam's razor is a very simple principle, which is the simplest answer is usually the correct one. So if you go back through the history of thousands and thousands of years, you'll find that these beings have always been here. You know, they don't say they came from far away on other planets. And I know that what Sitchin said about Nibiru and so forth, and I know, you know, about the watchers and the 200 watchers being stationed on the moon, just like the Yagigi and all the rest of it. But all this stuff is still centralized to the general area of the Earth.
Mm-hmm.
It's all – the focus is on the genetic biodiversity of the Earth, the garden, okay? So like you were saying from my book, no matter how outrageous these forms seem initially to people who are having these experiences or these encounters, if you take an objective look at what they're seeing, even though they're initially shocked – there's nothing that they're seeing that does not conform to an earthly vertebrate template. Two arms, two legs, central trunk, one head, two eyes. You know, in fact, if you go back into the earlier part of the 20th century, there were more strange forms seen then, more bizarre UFO knots, for instance, than there are now,
mm-hmm.
by far. Okay, the range was a little more strange. Again, though, they all still had the same characteristics of genetic life here. You know, if you were from somewhere in a very remote area and someone said, hey, I want to show you something. They took you in a warehouse and they showed you an elephant, a giraffe, a Maasai warrior, a penguin, a hermit crab, and an octopus. And you'd never seen any of these things before and you had no idea what they were. You would think, where in the world did those come from?
Yep.
What is that? You know, you would have a hard time believing they all came from the same planet, is what I'm saying. But they do. They all have a common genetic heritage because they're all part of the biosphere here.
Mm-hmm.
And it's the same thing with these beings. There's no reason whatsoever to believe that they come from somewhere else.
And this situation is much bigger than just the sector of, you know, aliens. But
right.
Another great point about the alien idea is that if you go back and you look at like the big wave of UFOs in the 50s, 40s and 50s, it seems like the technology that the crafts are using has only really, it seems to go parallel with us. You know, that's why a lot of people now are saying they think they were secret government crafts, but maybe there's some other type of being that has a parallel technology that may be 50 years ahead of ours, but it's not so radical that it seems like it came from Zeta Reticuli.
Right. Well, if you look at it historically, you'll find, for instance, in the Middle Ages, in the Dark Ages, they were encountering these same beings, except at that time they called them sylphs, fairies, things like this. And these beings at that time had technology, but it was called magical, you know, magical technology, items, whatever. Charlemagne declared war on what he called the princes of the air, okay, or the kingdom of the air, because these supposedly wooden ships were coming by sky, in the air, and they were raiding farms and stealing not just livestock, but young women. And Charlemagne became so angry that he gathered together his armies and marched them out onto the plain and screamed at the sky for a while, and of course they never came down to fight. Then you go forward a few hundred years or several hundred years, and you'll have other updates to this thing where, for instance, a ship was seen that supposedly threw an anchor and it got stuck on the steeple of a church.
Wow.
It's as if their technology has always been just a shade ahead of where we currently are.
Right.
Or at least in appearance, in the way they present themselves. Obviously, if you've got something that looks like a wooden ship but it's flying, that's actually some sort of advanced technology. But they don't have a lot of imagination, okay? They basically try to stay right ahead of the popular concepts in our popular culture, whatever our current popular culture is at the time. During the 1800s, we had the mystery airship flap. Well, at that time, there were no Zeppelins flying around at all. And the hot air balloon was not widely known or was barely getting started. But here were these airships flying around, the southwest of the United States. And, you have to ask, are they keeping up with our popular culture or our subconscious in some way?
Mm-hmm.
Because, again, you move forward from that point and you come to the beginning of the UFO age as we know it now, where, Kenneth Arnold sees the discs over Mount Rainier. And before that happened, there was another guy named Richard Shaver,
yes,
who had written about these subterranean ancients who lived inside the earth. And, a lot of people consider Shaver a crackpot. In some ways, he might have been, but he still seems to have known something because there are so many things he wrote about which are still very much in ufology today and in witness accounts today. Everything from abduction, subterranean bases, silver disc-shaped craft, which he said were kept in the caves, interest in human genetics, all this stuff. And that was before Arnold had his sighting. Arnold had his sighting of silvery craft. Or they might have been, they weren't exactly disc-shaped, but somehow out of that, he described them as skipping like saucers. So flying saucers stuck. Well, as soon as he said that, what do we start seeing? We start seeing saucer shapes.
Mm-hmm.
So they appear to update their presentation to us to match whatever our current expectation is. And if we're reading science fiction, since the pulp age of science fiction, and we're expecting aliens from outer space, well, then how are they going to present themselves? They're going to put on that mask, and they're going to come and say, yeah, that's who we are.
Right. Why not? If the misdirection is already laid out for you, why not just step into that role and make it easy on yourself?
Exactly.
And I know the Richard Shaver saga is pretty popular. We've always kind of glossed over it. Like, it's come up a time or two, but we hadn't really looked at it in any serious depth. But tell us a little bit more about the details of what he was talking about. He was talking about two underground races that were kind of at war with each other, right?
Yeah, he basically was talking about what he believed was a hard materialistic reality. He was pretty much an atheist. He, had a lot of issues, and he even spent some time, in an asylum for a few months.
Hmm.
But, how many times do you hear about people who've had these types of experiences having a breakdown?
Right.
That type of thing. He basically was a guy who was working with a welding gun, and back during that time, the welding guns were highly dangerous. They produced a really powerful electromagnetic field. And while he was welding, when he would run the welding gun, he would start hearing voices, and the voices did not appear to be aware of him. They were just talking, talking about the people above them making noise and all this kind of stuff and all the terrible things they were doing to people and how hilarious it was and so forth, which of course ties right in with, demonology and, mm-hmm. and things of this nature. But Shaver basically at first thought he was losing it. And then he started seeing evidence that there was something going on because what they would say would correspond to something that he would see happen. And so at some point, he claimed that they basically came after him, and he ended up being taken to the caves because I guess that he had figured out something or they realized he was listening in or whatever. But Shaver claimed that, and he did this first through a science fiction story, which he sent as a true account to Amazing Stories. And Ray Palmer, the editor of Amazing Stories, found the account where an editor had thrown it in the trash can. He pulled it out of the trash, saw the letter that Shaver had written, and said, man, this is great stuff. So he contacted him. He said, can I use this? He said, sure. He said, well, I'm going to add some stuff to it. So Palmer then embellished it with all kinds of sci-fi trappings and so forth. But basically, it was Shaver's account of what he had been told had happened before the flood or the great cataclysm. He claimed, you know, that there were two races on Earth that were like basically correspondent to the Nephilim. They were giant peoples. They were hybrid peoples, sometimes mixed with animals genetically. This type of thing. And this has been done through advanced elder science. And something happened, something cataclysmic. The sun changed its solar radiation, or was going to, and they figured out that the surface of the Earth would become inhospitable to them, so that the elite of these groups left the planet and went elsewhere in our solar system, most likely. At that point, those who were left behind went underground to avoid the rays of a now poisonous sun. Hmm. It's interesting, if you look at it, you'll find that in the first in the Sumerian king list, and in the books, in the patriarch accounts, the list of patriarchs in the Old Testament, both, you'll see that each successive generation after the flood, the lifespan got shorter and shorter and shorter. And I mean, it went from hundreds of years successively down to scores of years.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. As if something had changed. You'll find again, you know, in the apocryphal books, it will talk about how many of these sons of the fallen were locked beneath the earth. And it says it's like a punishment, and their fathers are locked there permanently as a punishment or until the day of judgment. You know, as the book of Jude, which quotes from the book of Enoch, says, you know, angels who kept not their first estate, but were reserved in chains of darkness until the judgment of the great day. So, you know, the concept is there that these beings fled beneath the surface or were forced beneath the surface. But again, this is a theme that you see all the way up to the present day, you know, whether you're dealing with anomalous humanoids of just about any type. Okay. For instance, Bigfoot, there's an association with low-lying areas, more, it's just as much as there are mountainous areas, but there are usually caves, sumps, sinkholes, grottos, you know, these types of things nearby,
mm-hmm.
wherever you see these types of beings. And not just Bigfoot, El Chupacabras, the same way, in the El Yunque rainforest in Puerto Rico, there are gigantic, extensive cave systems that have never been explored, right there where they've been seeing this thing. So, you know, if there are beings here that essentially have a subterranean environment that they mainly dwell in, they would come out, you know, primarily to partake of what our environment has to offer, and then they would return to where they came from. And you see that a lot of times with the sudden disappearance of anomalous humanoids and anomalous creatures, they'll be hot on the track of these things, and then boom, they're just gone. And of course, all of these things have been seen in conjunction with tunnels, mines, caves, you know, the list goes on and on. It just makes sense. Even if you're talking about lake monsters, there are often associations with underwater cavern systems. So,
yeah, I do. I love the possibility of different creatures and humanoid races living in the inner earth. But one of the things that my logical brain can't get over is why these seemingly more advanced beings would just surrender the surface to us. You know, the beaches, the mountains, the sunrise and sunset. There's a lot of amazing things to enjoy on the surface. It seems weird that they'd be okay with just staying below ground, unless, of course, they had to.
Well, unless they had to. If you look at what they do, they tend to come out mainly by night or at dusk, just like the fairy folk of old, you know, or trolls or whatever, who fear the sun. So basically what they're doing is, they avoid sunlight as much as they can. Even with the so-called grays and other types of so-called extraterrestrials that have been seen, they usually have or often have these dark eyes, these huge dark eyes. Okay, if you have huge eyes, those are not the eyes of a space-faring species.
Mm-hmm.
Because space is the most hostile environment imaginable for the eye, okay? The radiation is so intense that any creature which evolved or was even designed to live in deep space or travel throughout space a great bit would have smaller eyes. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
These beings have enormous eyes, and nocturnal creatures are the creatures that have enormous eyes. Creatures that dwell in the dark to a large extent are creatures that have enormous eyes. And of course, there are those who claim that they have seen these beings take off the black covering, and it's basically like a giant contact lens. And there's an enormous reptilian or humanoid eye beneath the covering. So again, these are all indicators that these beings are subterranean. When you look at accounts, for instance, of the Greys themselves and how they move, they're described as having sort of a sideways shuffling gait. You know, they don't take big strides and so forth. And they kind of mill around almost like ants, okay? And if you were a species that moved, you know, in narrow ways beneath the earth, that's the way you would move. And that's probably the body and the head configuration that you would have.
Yeah, I think that makes sense to me. And we were talking about how these stories of these kind of beings, they span multiple cultures, multiple time periods. Let's step back a little bit and highlight some of these similarities amongst the stories. Tell us about a couple of the legends we hear from the East that kind of fit this mold.
Well, you know, in Japan, for instance, you have a story about a fisherman who is taken beneath the sea. And he is taken by the king under the sea, and he is taken down there to marry the king's daughter, to create a hybrid offspring. And of course, the king is portrayed as a dragon, okay, a reptilian. If you go to China, you find the same thing. You find the dragon kings who live under the earth, and they too are interested in human genetics, and they come and they take people for purposes of procreation. If you go to the Indian subcontinent and to the Himalayas, you'll find the legend of the Naga folk, the Naga people, who are reptilian humanoids. They are described as looking like snakes or serpents, but they have a human body. And it's interesting because they, too, are obsessed with kidnapping humans, not just for procreation and sexual pleasure and so forth, but for sadistic purposes, which, of course, ties in with UFO encounters and what they do to people, and also as a food resource. So this is in all those legends too. And you know, speaking of the Naga in the Old Testament, in the Bible, we're told in the very beginning, there's a reptilian humanoid that shows up. He's walking on two legs. He comes into the garden, and what does he do? He attempts to seduce the woman. And in Hebrew, the word for the serpent in the garden is Nahash, okay, which is very, very close to Naga.
It is.
You could actually spell it N-A-G-H-A-S-H or N-A-H-A-S-H. You come to the New World and you have the Nahuatl, which again is a serpent type being. This is a theme that you find all over the world, that these subterranean beings are older, that there's something reptilian about some of them, not all of them, but some of them, as if they're somehow tied in with older species on the planet, and that they're very, very fascinated, in fact, dependent upon procreation with the human race. And even in folk and fairy lore of Europe, you'll find the same thing. You have the frog prince. This whole idea in very watered down form of a sort of a reptilian / amphibian humanoid who seduces a woman and says, hey, you know, I may be hideous to you, but I'm really a wealthy and powerful prince. And if you will just mate with me, I will give you everything that you want. I will fulfill all your wishes. And so this is a theme. And of course, that keep in mind that frog prince comes out of a deep well. Mm-hmm. He's found in a well. So again, you know, this is a theme that is universal. It even exists in Native American folklore.
Right. Yeah. The Native Americans, they have quite a few different tribes have really awesome stories. But I think the one that struck me as the most interesting in your book was the Choctaw Indians. I think they have some pretty rich lore about their local mound area, right?
Yeah, they do. There's a mound. There's a mound that's open to the public, and they advertise that as the Nanawaya mound or cave mound, but it's not. There's another one that in the last decade or so has been locked away from people. You know, you're really not supposed to go in there and see it. It's back in the swamp, in some woods, and it's a natural formation, or so they say. It's just this huge outcrop of stone and earth, just jutting up out of this swampland. And there are caves in the front, little caves in the front that you can see, but there's actually a bigger entrance around back that has been cemented shut. It's underneath some sort of deck work that they put up to cover it up, I guess. But they had to, they sealed that shut, and the legend, not the legend, the rumor is that some people went down in there and never came back, which is kind of interesting because it's not that big of a mound.
Yeah.
So they, if to go down there and not come back, you know, that there must be some tunnels in there. But they claim that in some of their legends, they say they came out of that mound themselves. In other legends, they say that there are all kinds of creatures that, come out of that mound from the underworld. Shompi, which is their version of Bigfoot, and also Bopoli, which are like little rock throwers, little hairy men that live in the woods and throw rocks. All these types of creatures, a whole range of creatures that supposedly live in and around that area, but actually throughout this whole area where I live, because I'm in Mississippi too. But that's basically, you know, a serious part of their lore. In fact, one of the times when I made a trip to that actual cave mound, there was one time I went there with some other people, and as we neared the mound, we started hearing drums, and there wasn't supposed to be anybody there, and we stood there for a few minutes listening, and then I see a what looked like a naked guy run across the top of the mound, and he never came down, and we walked around, and we went up the mound. There was nobody there. Now, I'm thinking maybe we interrupted somebody's vision quest, okay? Maybe somebody was there doing something personal and we interrupted it. But another time, okay, this is a sacred site to the Choctaw. And once an entire busload of Native Americans from Oklahoma had come all the way to this mound on sort of a pilgrimage, and I happened to be there at the time, and I was up there taking some pictures and with some of my kids and stuff, and this bus pulls up, and all these people start getting out, and you know, they're regular middle class folks and so forth. And they go running over to the mound, and some of them are bending down real low and looking in the little caves that you can crawl into if you are feeling real brave, which I wouldn't recommend.
Right.
And this one lady stands back. She's very, very she's like a school teacher or something, you know. Or a nurse. I mean, a very professional looking lady with glasses, and she's standing back. And I mean, she stood back like, you know, 60 yards. And I was talking to her and everything, and she was telling me about how they came there and why and so forth. And I looked over where these other people were, and I said, "Aren't you going to go and at least, you know, look down, look inside that little cave?" And she said, "I'm not going anywhere near those caves." And I said, "Why?" And she said, "Because Bigfoot lives in there." That was it. And that was it. And I looked at her and I said, "Really?" And she said, "I'm serious." She said, "There's no way I'm going near those holes." So this is a very deep belief for them that there's something otherworldly about that site. But there are other places like that all over North America where Native Americans believe that either they came out of the earth or there are other things that dwell in the earth that are better left alone.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I just love that story about the Choctaw, because you have this area, this big public display where they're drawing attention, and then you have this little secret area that no one really is talking about. It's classic misdirection.
Well, you know, and that's their business. You know, the way I look at it is that's a sacred site to them. I consider myself lucky to have gotten to go see it a few times.
Yeah,
I wouldn't want somebody tramping all, if it were my sacred site, I wouldn't want somebody trampling around all over it either.
That's true.
It's sort of a pet peeve of mine anyway, because I'll see on different articles and on television and so forth where they'll come in and they'll dig up this huge site and they'll dig up all these people and they'll take them away. You know, and I'm sitting here thinking, how would you feel if somebody went to the graveyard where your grandparents were buried and they did that?
Right. That is true. And you mentioned, of course, we see similarities to the legends and the myths of Europe, and the fact that, as we talked about, one of the themes is a lot of times the involvement has to do with royalty and genetic manipulation and bloodlines. And so when we get into these stories coming out of Great Britain and Ireland, that is super interesting to me because, of course, it's a big umbrella, but I consider this a conspiracy show.
Right.
And this is kind of where these two things cross over a little bit almost.
Well, they do, and it's interesting to me. I had never heard of David Icke, for instance, when I wrote the first edition of this book. And then he quoted extensively from the first edition in one of his books. I'm not sure which one it was. It might have been Children of the Matrix. It was in one of his books. He quoted quite extensively from it. I'm not a believer in most of what he promulgates, mm-hmm. but he does come up with some interesting connections and some interesting research. And some of the stuff he comes up with seems to be legit. Now, I don't believe that people are shape-shifting humanoids. I don't think that that's what's going on with these royals or any of this type of stuff. What he may be describing may be a form of demonic possession.
Right.
Okay. Something electromagnetic going on. I remember back during the 2000 election, there were people all over the place who said that they saw Al Gore do something really strange when he was on television, where he was in a live interview. He was very angry about the election results, that which were still not decided, and he was being very, very belligerent. And a whole bunch of people, credible people, said that when he did this, that his skin tone started flickering and everybody else around him stayed normal. He started changing sort of color and started like going from green and red, and then his eyes started looking really strange, like bulging in black, and then it went away. And when this happened, it was all over the internet. Well, now it's not. It's gone. I basically, at that time, I said, well, that's interesting. I'm going to see if I can find that video. It had been on YouTube and stuff. It was gone. So I contacted somebody at CNBC because I figured, well, if anybody's, you know, nonpartisan, it's CNBC. So I contacted them, not CNBC, excuse me, C-SPAN. Definitely not CNBC.
There we go.
Yeah, C-SPAN. And so I contacted C-SPAN because they are highly nonpartisan. And I was talking to a guy. He said, oh, yeah. He said, I remember seeing that. He said, I thought that was really weird. And I said, that was really strange. He said, I couldn't figure that out. And he said, I'll see if I can get the video for you. So I waited and I waited. And I sent him a message. Well, I'm still looking for it. I sent him a message. He sends me back a message. I'm still looking for it. Finally, he sends me an email. He says, look, he says, I literally cannot find that video clip anywhere. He said, it has been totally removed from every archive source that we had. He said, it's gone.
Wow.
See, when you hear things like that, you have to say, you know, what is the deal here? Is there a conspiracy about this type of stuff? Now, do I believe that Gore is a reptilian shapeshifter? No, I don't. I think that what you're seeing is a disturbance in the electromagnetic field that was somehow localized to him, and that the cameras were picking it up, what the human eye couldn't see.
That could very well be. I have a hard time. A lot of those videos are up on YouTube, and because of Photoshop and editing, I have such a hard time drawing any kind of conclusion from them. But you can't deny that a theme amongst these myths is preservation of bloodlines and life extension and some type of genetic manipulation. And that's also the theme of the history of our planet's elite, as far as I can tell.
It is. And, you know, the underworld itself, these hidden races that live under the ground are associated with forbidden and hidden knowledge, which they keep for themselves, longevity, immortality, you know, all these things. And so there seems to be a connection. When you look at, for instance, the Arthurian legends and the legend of the Lady in the Lake, well, the Lady in the Lake lives in a cave under the lake, okay? And she's very, very concerned with making sure that Arthur gets to be king.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Then again, you look at legends like Rumpelstiltskin, and here we have this little, basically a troll or a goblin who lives under the ground, and he's very, very interested, again, in obtaining the child from the princess. Mm-hmm. He wants that child, which is a royal bloodline. So, yeah, this is a theme that you find throughout history, and you don't just find it in Europe. You find it in the Far East, too. So mm-hmm. it's something that you find. You know, it leads back to this whole idea of those who believe that they have a divine right to rule. But their divine right, in spite of what people who are into the Merovingian heresies and stuff think, their belief of divine right is really not about being descended from Christ and Mary Magdalene. Their belief of divine right goes much, much further back, mm-hmm. you know, back into the most distant mist of antiquity, all the way back to ancient Sumer, okay, to the Sumerians.
Yeah.
And it always has to do with non-human beings who basically set up their offspring, their hybrid offspring, to rule. And this is a theme that has come all the way down to us today, and that's what David Icke is kind of continuing with the stuff he talks about.
A lot of dots, I think, connect here, because a major conspiratorial theme is that the elite are communicating with something non-human. And the two main ways people talk about it is either they're taking orders from some alien race, or they're using occult magic rituals to communicate with some spiritual entity. And I think you could also say a third possibility is that there are beings that exist here on the Earth that have probably had an evolution that lasts longer than ours, or maybe they survived the last cataclysm, so they have more information about this planet than we do.
Right.
And all you have to have is a few contacts in special places, the Vatican, secret societies. You have a few contacts,
right.
You know, the British royals, and by only communicating with less than 100 humans, you could pretty much control the surface like a chessboard.
Well, sure. And if you look at it, I mean, all these things could still be interconnected to some in some way. I mean, these very ancient races that would set up their puppets to control human governments, they could also have bloodlines that go millions of years back.
Right.
Okay. Whether they're hominids or reptilians or whatever. And when I say reptilian, understand that so-called dinosaurs were warm-blooded creatures.
Mm-hmm.
They were endothermic. Some of them have feathers so fine that they were basically hair. Okay. So over millions of years, they would probably look just as much like mammals as mammals do. Okay.
That's true.
Sure. So this whole idea of the seed of the serpent, it's a prevalent theme around the world. And it's part of a lot of secret society stuff too. And if you go look, for instance, in the book of Daniel chapter 2, Daniel says, when he's talking to Nebuchadnezzar about human history based on Nebuchadnezzar's dream of this statue of different materials, and he basically says the last age of the earth or human history, there's going to be a final empire. And the statue that Nebuchadnezzar saw had feet that were made of iron mixed with what the King James Version calls miry clay or crumbly clay. Hmm. And Daniel says, He's interpreting the dream, and the different areas of the statue of different metals correspond to a different empire. And the feet, he says, are the last age. And he says, for as you saw iron mixed with miry clay, so shall they seek to mingle themselves with the seed of men, but it will not hold.
Mm.
So again, here's this theme that even until the very end of time, that these beings are always going to be trying to genetically mix with Homo sapiens.
And it will not hold.
And it will not hold. And if it does not hold, that would explain why they have to keep coming back.
Right.
Yeah.
That's fascinating. And another thing from your book that I love in this whole thread of these beings maybe being in the shadows and being the real puppet masters.
Right.
There's a pattern of world leaders and generals getting strange visitations that you could argue are forms of this manipulation too, right?
Right, right. I mean, Napoleon had a visitor they called the Dark Man. You know, he would just show up in his chambers and he was even seen by his generals and they thought he was the devil. And he would come and he would be seen leaving secret conferences when no one went in, things of this nature. Hitler also had a guy like this. They called him the Tibetan.
Yeah.
This strange character would show up and then depart or just vanish. And it's interesting because Hitler himself said, you know, one of his main rationales was he wanted to create a so-called master race, but he was basing this on a race that he claimed that he had contact with. And the message that he said that he basically got was, we have to make ourselves like them or they will destroy us when they take over the earth, basically. He said, I have seen the new man. He is intrepid and cruel. I was afraid of him.
Wow.
So this type of manipulation of world leaders seems to be par for the course for these beings. And, you know, in biblical terms, they would have called these beings principalities and powers, you know, some sort of being that may be something that is beyond what we can understand as physically real, even though it can be physically real, but it manipulates our civilization.
Yeah, and now people have plenty of stories of seeing a Nordic race of aliens that have blonde hair and blue eyes.
Right.
And I don't know, you just say Napoleon sees a guy and Hitler sees a guy. I mean, just right there, by changing the way those two people think and maybe altering their actions, I mean, that's a huge change in human history, just making those two appearances.
Well, sure. I mean, this is a theme that goes, again, all the way back. I mean, Alexander the Great, you know, he believed he was the son of one of the gods. And he went to an oracle in the Libyan desert when he was in North Africa with his army. And they told him, you know, yeah, you definitely are. Yeah, you're one of them, you know. And so he had this whole idea that therefore he was entitled to conquer the earth. Okay. And he had a lot of strange things which were chronicled, you know, during his advance across to Asia Minor and into India. He laid siege to one city, and he could not get through the wall. And a flying shield was said to have shown up and shattered the wall with a lightning bolt. And then again, when he was crossing a river or about to cross a river in India, he was opposed by so-called flying shields, silvery shields that came out of the river and attacked his army. So, of course, to him, these are gods, because it's in their interest for him to believe they are gods, because then he will do whatever they say. He will believe he has divine right to rule, all this type of stuff, in the same way that today it's in their interest for us to believe they're aliens from somewhere far, far away.
Yeah, man, I am loving this theme. And I think even Constantine claimed to have some big vision in the sky that made him convert the whole Roman Empire to a Christian nation. Now, that is some serious influence. And the cliff note of that visitation is either accepted by people who want to believe the religious narrative, or it's just dismissed. But there is a third option, that some dark, ancient, underground power center looking to increase influence on the surface used divine intervention as a way to pull Rome's puppet strings.
Well, sure. I mean, even now we have something called Project Bluebeam, which supposedly we haven't used, but I don't believe that for a minute. I think we probably use it all the time. And it's used to create these types of hallucinations or images, or I want to say hallucinations, holographs probably would be a better word, holograms in the sky, holographic images. You know, they use these things to manipulate whole populations. You know, if you were to create an image, well, even recently they supposedly had an image of a flying horse over Mecca, which ties right in with something from Muslim eschatology about the end times, that you would see this flying horse, which is the Barak, which is what it's actually called, that Muhammad flew on in one night from Mecca and Medina to Jerusalem and back.
So, interesting name too.
Yeah, exactly. But very interesting. It's a thing that we have to ask, are we doing that? Is somebody else doing that? Who's causing these types of manipulations? And Richard Shaver said, you know, that the subterrestrials, I mean, way back in the early 20th century, before the first major UFO sighting by Kenneth Arnold, Shaver was saying, you know, that these beings could create realistic looking, even solid appearing holograms in our skies, in our oceans, that would even show up on radar, and then they would just disappear.
Hmm.
Well, how many times has that been reported in UFO cases?
Right, man. Maybe these underground races have been using Project Bluebeam longer than we've been alive. I had also read, and I'm sure you already know this, but apparently Lewis and Clark and also Columbus wrote about these flying candles that would hover around them, which is a lot like the orbs people talk about seeing today.
No, I actually haven't heard that about Lewis and Clark, but it wouldn't surprise me. I think that there was probably a high civilization here in North America at one point. And a lot of these anomalous events tie into that. And I think that these ancient beings that we're talking about are also a part of that. They, you know, just as anywhere else, they're behind the scenes manipulating cultures and civilizations. I mean, even going back to the Hopi tale of the ant people and the snake people, I mean, you have the same theme of these subterranean beings. In that case, they were helping them survive. But, you know, it's just a theme that you see again and again, that they are here.
Mm-hmm.
This is where they are.
Yeah, another Indian tribe that had those type of stories. I can't remember the name of the tribe, but when they had met the Spanish explorers, they were talking about a being or something they would see called Mr. Bad Thing. I learned about this from your book. Can you tell the people about that a little bit?
Sure. Señor Malacosa is what they called him. Well, that's what Da Gama called him, that. And Vasco Da Gama was, you know, an explorer who came through the southeastern United States and over into the Texas region. And he claimed that he had met these Native Americans who said that this thing called Señor Malacosa was this being that came out of the ground and terrorized them. And the thing about this is that, again, this is, it's a thing where these people have been conditioned. No, it wasn't Vasco da Gama, it was Cabeza de Vaca, excuse me. Cabeza de Vaca was exploring the region. And these Native Americans were being totally controlled by their fear of this being. So basically, they said that this thing would show up and he would dress as a male or a female, basically trying to seduce people. He would never eat if they offered him food, but he would tell them that he came from down inside the earth through a crevice that was nearby. He would take people apart and put them back together, which is, again, a theme that you find in ufology with the intrusive surgeries and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, I mean, this is nothing new. And he was also accompanied by a bright light and an electrical sensation that would paralyze the victim. He had a wand which had a glowing end on it, which he would use as a weapon. You know, all these things are right out of ufology.
Right. It's a weird thing because, like, just in the past 200 years, I wonder if there's been major changes to the way these beings interact with us. Because when you look at old writings, it seems like they're just coming right up and talking to people whenever they choose to. They're flying around in the sky whenever they choose to. But it's almost like as our technology has advanced, as we've become more of a global society on the surface, they've even taken another further step back. At least that's what it seems to me. I mean, do you notice a difference in the way people talked about it today versus back then?
Yeah, I think so. I think that they realize now that people are not going to believe they're gods. So they're not going to be able to control people in that way. So they have to now put on this disguise of being aliens.
Yeah.
Because if they say they're aliens and they can come and say, oh yeah, well see, we've been monitoring your evolution and you're doing bad things and you need to do what we say or you're going to destroy yourselves. You're going to destroy your planet. Of course, it's their planet too because they live here. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
But they're coming around with that same old disinformation campaign. It's just, you know, it's changed slightly. It's basically, we're from somewhere far away. You can't get to where we are, but we're here for your own good. And, you know, you see this with the ancient alien concept, which is we created you.
Yeah.
You know, yeah. You're our property. You belong to us. You know, these types of things. And this is a very insidious form of mind control. It's designed to convince human beings that you are not autonomous, that you are not your own master. You are not in control of yourself and your own destiny. You know, and people should be very, very careful about anybody, human, non-human, religious leader, political leader, or so-called alien that comes and tells you that they know what's best for you, that don't think for yourself, just do what you're told. And I think that's where a lot of this UFO encounter stuff is leading, and I think that's where a lot of the ancient alien stuff is eventually going to end up.
Yeah, man, I like what you're saying there. And the themes of the ancient aliens idea and also modern alien encounters jive so well with religion as a control system too. It's like we swapped out the spiritual lens for a scientific one, but the same story with God. He lives somewhere you can't reach. He knows what's best for you. He has a plan. He made the rules that you need to follow.
And he made you. He created you.
Exactly, yeah.
He's in charge of your destiny. Yeah, it's exactly the same.
Well, what if some of these underground beings are responsible for creating the three major religions?
Well, think about this, too. I mean, people are easily manipulated. Even if they mean well, even if they are knowledgeable, even if they're putting genuine evidence together in a seemingly real picture, you know, solving a puzzle. But what if all this stuff's being fed to them intentionally in some way?
Yeah, man, I love it. I'm starting to think it's all fed to us by some non-human source, and it's usually framed as archons or demons or Anunnaki, but this idea that it comes from an intelligence that lives in the shadows and beneath the surface with a few topside agents, you know, oh, maybe that's why they steal babies to raise them as their own and put them in power positions on the surface and then work through the bloodlines for as long as they can. But it seems totally feasible to me. And I also wanted to ask you, now I know you aren't really a hollow earth guy, but when it comes to the composition of the planet, do you think there's any major variation from the conventional model? If they manipulate us in so many ways, you think they'd have lies for that too?
Well, you know, it's an interesting question. And I do, in all fairness, because the book is largely about subterranean mysteries, I do talk about the hollow earth in one chapter to some extent, you know, mostly that whole chapter. But we have no way of knowing what the inner configuration is because we've never been there. We can guess, we can estimate, we can do tests and hypotheses and see if the test results match the hypotheses. We can interpret data that we gather. But ultimately, if, for instance, we had a protostar or a quasar that was stable or some other strange form at the center of the planet that was extremely dense and had a specific charge and spin, then we might just assume it was a nickel iron core.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay. We have no way of knowing this. It's all guesswork, you know.
It is.
It's just kind of like one of my favorite stories is about a guy named Wegener. And Alfred Wegener, he He proposed a theory back during the early part of the 20th century about something he called continental drift. And he looked at the shape of the continents and he said, well, these continents, once all fit together as a puzzle, just like puzzle pieces, and they slowly drifted apart. Well, he came up with this theory and he was destroyed. He lost his credibility. He lost his academic standing, you know, so forth and so on. Well, now, you know, you fast forward several decades and somebody else comes around along and says, oh, guess what? All these planets, all these continents used to fit together when the planet was young and we had a great continent. It was called Pangaea. Well, that's what Wegener was saying. Mm-hmm. Then another guy comes forward and says, oh, guess what? We're floating around on these plates and they're pulling the continents apart. We call this plate tectonics. Okay. So there's Wegener's theory, except now it's accepted. And you see the same kind of thing happen with a lot of anomalous things that people scoff at. You know, who knows what the future will hold for Hollow Earth theory? We don't know. You know, I don't personally subscribe to it one way or the other.
Yeah.
I have to say I'm agnostic about it.
Yeah.
So I think that the planet itself demonstrably is much more complex than we are led to believe. You know, the crust of the Earth is highly complex. It's filled with gaps and voids and holes and tunnels and cavern systems and all this stuff. And even, as you know from my book, you know, at the crust mantle boundary, there's a worldwide anomalous region called the Moho-Rovacic discontinuity, or the Moho for short. And the Moho is worldwide. It exists. It is real. And the U.S. Navy has tried to drill to it. The Russians have tried to reach it. Nobody has succeeded in reaching it. But we find that there's this largely vacuous area, very deep, at high pressure. And it shows up in seismology, in seismic readings, as valleys and troughs and mountains and things like this. So is it full of water? Is it full of liquid fire? Is it full of air? You know, we have no way of knowing. Are there oceans in there that are being evaporated by heat? And then that's in turn resulting in the never-ending continuous supply of fresh oxygen that is blowing out of large cave systems around the world.
Yeah. I thought that was really interesting too, because I've been near a few caves and you feel that air coming out and you're like, yeah, where is that coming from?
Right. Where's it coming from? And, you know, whether it's Lechuguilla Cave, you know, in New Mexico, or Blowing Cave in Arkansas, or Mammoth Cave, or the huge cave that's over in Vietnam, you know, these caves are constantly blowing fresh oxygenated air. Constantly.
Mm-hmm.
And so there's got to be a source for that. It's not just being generated down, you know, by the solid nickel iron core, okay? So there has to be an inner area where that oxygen exists, or where hydrogen, H2O actually, is probably being broken down into hydrogen and oxygen and expelled. And that would be something that would happen if there were internal oceans, which now we know all the time we hear news about another internal ocean being found in the crust somewhere. Yep. And if these bodies of water being converted into oxygen by heat, that would explain, that air pressure.
Yeah. And I'm kind of with you on the Hollow Earth. I love the idea of it, but it's some of the theories of its composition are so radically different than what we know. It's hard to wrap my head around the idea of an inner sun or something. But when you bring up this Moho layer between the crust and the mantle, that is really all I need. Because in terms of surface area, it's the same. You know, it could be as just as vast with continents and oceans and all kinds of stuff right beneath our surface. And it doesn't really matter to me if it's looking inward or outward, because that's really the difference we're talking about with a hollow earth theory. It's just that they'd be pointed inward towards the inner sun. But if there's a layer like an Oreo, like a layer of cream in between our crust and mantle,
yeah,
that's just as much surface area. There could be plenty of continents there. The whole Shangri-La thing could be there.
Yeah.
Lot of possibilities. Well, right on. Mike, this has been a fascinating show. I love that book. I hope we can do it again because there's so much more stuff we didn't even touch on. But before I let you go, would you like to tell the people about some of your other work and website and anything else you got going on?
Sure. You know, I've got I just say go to gravedistractions.com. That's my publisher, gravedistractions.com. And there you can find all but one of my books. You can find Caverns, Caldrons, and Concealed Creatures, the third edition. Please get the third edition. It is much more expansive, has a lot more material in it, and it will cost you less, and the others are out of print, or they are supposed to be out of print. And so, yeah, get the third edition. You can get the third edition of Caverns, Caldrons, and Concealed Creatures at Amazon or Barnes & Noble. You can also get This Tragic Earth. You can get both of these books in Kindle, Nook, or print. Okay, and all the other digital formats too. I also have a couple of fantasy novels which deal with some of these themes. They're together in one volume. It's called The Pulsifer Saga. The Pulsifer Saga, and it's really, really enjoyable stuff, people tell me. It's also at Amazon, and it is also at gravedistractions.com. I recommend going through Grave Distractions to click on the links for these books because that way you'll be sure and get the latest and greatest edition. The Pulsifer Saga is now in a third illustrated edition, and that's the one that you want to get. And, again, it's a better deal too. So, and, of course, I have This Tragic Earth, Richard, the Art and World of Richard Sharpe Shaver, and another book called Pulp Winds, which is a bunch of short fiction that's been published in different magazines and web magazines and things like that. And it finally got collected together into an interesting collection of sort of adventure fiction, horror fiction, that kind of stuff, with some of these same themes present in it. And I guess the other one would be The Problem of Density in Regard to Non-Human Encounters, and that can only be found on Amazon, and that's not through Grave Distractions. And that's published by Interlight Communications. So that's it. Go to gravedistractions.com and look for my name under authors, and you'll find it.
Cool. Very awesome, man. Well, can't thank you enough. So glad Dean Dominic DeLucia pushed me to get in touch with you. It has been a real blast. Until next time, keep doing what you're doing, man, and take care of yourself out there, all right?
Thank you, Greg. You too. I appreciate it.
My God, people, I just love that episode. I think it's so compelling when you connect the dots that we talked about today. The story gets a little bit simpler, but you can still tie in so many loose ends. I really think this could be the whole damn thing. And it's a way to rectify some of the other ideas, like the theme that we can't really get into space, and that the planet's space agencies are just there to bullshit us. And to me, it bridges this gap between ancient priesthoods, modern secret societies, and this partnership between surface governments and some far-off alien races that take place in bases almost exclusively where? Underground. I also love this tie-in of religious manipulation, seeing visions of the Virgin Mary or a big cross in the sky, these poor fools being given their quote-unquote destiny by some manipulative inner earth entity waging wars for unknown reasons, using a form of Project Bluebeam on us. That's out there. But it answers a lot of strange questions, like why does a ship fly from Zeta Reticuli to Arizona and crash in the desert? Why do they have space travel, but yet a lacking genetics program? Why do they care about our genetics? Maybe these beings are the ones who introduced the ancients to the mystery schools and sacred geometry and maybe taught them how to enslave the globe through fractional reserve banking alchemy. Maybe the Babylonian banksters and the agents of the New World Order are the liaisons of the underworld. You know, Henry Kissinger seems half goblin to me. So do the Bushes and the Queen of England. There's a quality. And just like Mike said, how coincidental that we've had this history where a planet was covered with reptiles 65 million years ago, and now we have these stories of an ancient reptilian underground ruling presence. Maybe the reptilians' time was when dinosaurs and reptiles were the way life manifested here, but now the world is littered with mammals, and the highest form of humanoid is mammal. Maybe these reptilian beings aren't from some other place, but some other time. Unable to deal with the current surface sun since the big change in the solar system, whatever that may have been. Maybe Saturn was that brown dwarf star that Troy McLaughlin talked about. Now we're tying in Saturnian cults, reptilians, economic enslavement, underground bases, and we never had to leave the planet. Damn it, people. It's probably why there's so much mystery about Obama's past. He was a stolen child raised by the goblins of the inner earth, and that's who he works for. It seems so obvious now, right? Another point, Great Britain and Ireland are islands with a lot of this lore, like we talked about in the show, but if you want to farm humans and keep their genetics pure, islands are a good place to start until we start sailing around in ships, and then if you propagandize us to tell us that we could sail off the earth, maybe we won't go that far, right? I could do this all day, but if you didn't hear the Plus show, we do get into some more stories that fit into this subterranean creature mold. Stories of giants living in caves, feral cannibals living in caves, clues within the Human Genome Project, and what we're learning through tracing back our DNA and how this might jive with different races and pockets of underground manipulation, the RH blood type, and the connection to rich folklore in those areas, how this stuff could connect to how things behave at the quantum level, the aspect of different densities to these beings. Also, some examples where we see these ideas supported in the stories of Men in Black encounters. I'm into it, guys. I think there's something here. So if you want to hear more about this topic and the topics we do every show, please sign up for the low, low price of $5 for 5 shows a month at thehiresidechatsplus.com. I hope everyone has been liking the show lately. I feel like we're really on fire. I loved the episode I did with Crow about the lunar wave. I've gotten a couple other emails and messages that were a lot like the voicemail we heard in the intro, which is great. I love a little buzz. A listener called into Ground Zero with Clyde Lewis and gave me a little shout out, which was the highlight of my day yesterday, and also introduced Clyde to the lunar wave footage, and now Crow is going to be a guest on Ground Zero this Friday. Very happy to hear that. Thanks for spreading the word, people. We also have a supermoon coming up in just the next week. Crow and I are going to do a little THC update about the new info he's gotten in just the past 2 weeks and what it might mean for this crazy time. It's also, you know, it's prime time for observation, so be ready for some weirdness there if today's show wasn't enough for you. I'm also getting so many guest requests, it's tough to keep straight. A dozen or more a day sometimes. I'm really looking to tie in this underground theme to different things, and ideas about different compositions of the earth or space, those are fun ones. And I'm probably going to take it to some pretty weird extremes that I hope you are on board for exploring. I'd also love to do a show that focuses on the Vril Society and Agartha specifically, but I just got to find the right guest. So often someone suggests a topic but no guest, and that's the hard part a lot of the time. You have to make sure that over the course of 2 hours, somebody's going to be well-spoken and be able to handle the full topic. I really want to do a show that just hammers on the Vatican and their secrets, communication with entities, odd stuff they're doing with their observatories, occult rituals, Ratzinger, the secrets of the Vatican vaults, all that stuff in a Vatican secret super show. But I just can't find a guest who specializes in 2 hours of those angles. But we'll get there, I'm sure. We are still so much closer to the beginning of THC than we are the end. And that's a beautiful thing. So that said, I love you guys. Stay weird, stay strong, and manifest the best reality you can. The magic is there, I promise. And I've done my part this week. Your move, overlords of the underworld. Your frickin' move.